Mikey Pipes! Today is Tuesday, August 2nd, 2022. Me and Mrs. Pipe just got back from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, where yesterday it became official. Pipe Doctor is now officially licensed in the state of South Carolina for residential HVAC. Stay tuned for details. We're opening up shop real soon in conjunction with K Plumbing Service out of Lexington, South Carolina. We're making moves, ladies and gentlemen, and out all to you guys. Well, everyone on YouTube made it happen. All right, guys, I'm going on a service call. Customer's second floor air conditioning isn't working. Hopefully I can get some footage of that and show you how we get it done. All right, guys, let's get going. All
right, a 70, reading 70. Probably good. Let's lower that to 68. Let's go to 66. And let's see which unit is outside.
All right, filter is clean. We got airflow coming out of there and there. That's good. Love the railing. And here, we got one there, one there. Very big open loft over there with at least one. Okay, we have a closet, bathroom, all have vents. All right, let's go see what's going on outside. Let's check out the circuit breaker panel. All right. Here's all the units. Condenser. Condenser. One, two, three. All right, they all look good. All right, let's go check outside. Ma'am, one quick question. Is it possible that one of the circuits, because you said your husband went to the circuit breaker, started playing with things. Is it possible that one of them were off or tripped?
Yes.
Does he recall?
I think he thought one was
off or tripped.
Let me call him actually now.
Okay. Because there's a big difference between the two. Off, someone actually physically turned off the breaker. Tripped means something happened where it tripped.
I think
it was tripped. Okay.
So
I'll check outside. They're all on which side of the house?
Let me on this side of the house.
Okay.
When the circuit breaker was off, was it off or tripped?
Voice to text, gotta love it.
Ah, with the baby, it works well. Let's see. I saw it already. Perfect.
Good.
Modern technology. My basement is freezing.
It is kind of cold down there.
It's freezing. So I had your guys come and check why it's so cold, but there's nothing I can do this time.
Not sure. Okay. So the basement, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, five. I wonder why it's freezing in here. There's the equipment. So, here's one. There's one duct there. And we have another one there. We may be able to close them off if there are dampers up there, but. Okay, but one was tripped. Okay. We may be able to close off a couple of them. But also it's an interfere with the whole layout of the, let's put this oil-fired boiler. Look at this. I gotta call Steve Lav to work on this bad boy. I ain't touching this with a 10-foot pole. Okay. Venting. Looks nice. Not bad. I don't know why they would put an oil-fired boiler in here when you got gas. All right, since there's five vents here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we're like basement, subterranean, kind of, halfway, not really. It's like a lower level, it's not even a basement, but I close this one. All right, closed. closed. So we still have some air coming out of that one and that one. All right. I made her aware that I closed those three vents. Here's one unit, which is off. Here's the unit that's on. And I'm gonna assume that that's for the top floor. Yep, see? Oh, that's a second floor. This one says it's probably the first floor. Yeah. I'm gonna go turn that thermostat off and see if this turned off. All right, I killed the power. Well, I killed the cooling cycle at the thermostat and the unit turned off. So it's marked second floor, but she's referring to it as the third floor, but this is the unit. Another one came on. I believe that's for the ground floor. So let's take this panel off and check the electrical compartment. All right, so I got the cover off. I noticed you got a little bit of, looks like caulky here. It looks like a rubber band. And it matches up with, yeah, that was a rubber band. It got very hot in this compartment. Electric looks okay. Low voltage wiring looks okay. We have the C or common and the Y coming from the thermostat going to the brown and the yellow wire, which goes to brown and yellow here. So we don't have any low or high pressure switches inside. This is a single pole contactor. There's the stunt right there that connects L1 to T1. And this is marked L3 to T3, but we're gonna call that L1, L2, T1, T2. Here's our capacitor. Looks okay. Looks can be deceiving though. So we have a little bit of debris here. We'll clean that up. All right, make sure the wiring, you know, maybe get a little zip tie right there because the landscapers will assassinate that. So I'm gonna go back to the thermostat and we're gonna turn the call for cooling back on. I have to disconnect pulled and I should have used my right hand. That is correct, with my left hand behind my back. That way, God forbid, there is a short right here. The voltage is gonna go through your right arm, down your body, your right side of your body, and not going to the left side, which is where your heart is. So that's how I try to do it, especially on an older disconnect. If this was like a very fugazi, you know, wildebeest looking disconnect, I definitely would be doing it that way. So just a little tech tip. So let's go turn the power back on at the thermostat. Sorry, let's do a call for cooling back at the thermostat. I'll get my voltmeter out and we'll check for amperage once I plug it back in. See what she peaks out at when she first turns on and see what the running amperage is. And while we have it running, we'll dynamically test the capacitor, making sure that's good. All right, I just turned on the thermostat with a call for heat, set it for 64 degrees. As you can see, my contactor is now pulled in. And if you touch it, you can feel a little buzzing, feel a little vibration there. That's the 24 volt coil being pulled in and pushing in that pole, sending power, or the potential for power, across L3 to T3, right? This is the line side, this is the load side, okay? Now I'm gonna grab my Fluke multimeter and we're gonna test amperage once we plug this bad boy in. So, I like using the 802FC, put that on amperage. Oh. Left it on, so let's back to amperage. Put that bad boy right there. And I'm gonna clamp that around there. Now, as I plug this in, we're gonna see what the voltage jumps to. Sorry, the amperage jumps to. Here we go. 1, 2, 3. All right, not crazy. She didn't spike at all. Started around 10, went to 11, now 12, and slowly climbing. 12.8, 12.7. Okay, we're gonna let this run for a little bit, stabilize, and we'll check refrigerant pressures in a moment. But next we're gonna test our dual capacitor dynamically and see what rating that's running.
That's reading. The capacitance is reading.
All right, so first thing we're going to do is we're going to test for voltage, right, between common, right, and HIRM. So our common has four terminals, which is right there. Our HIRM has that, those three, right? And we're reading 322.3 volts. I'm going to use the underload capacitor test. This is by HVAC School. This is their app. You can download it in the App Store or the Google Play Store. It's a great, great resource. It has other tools like this that you can use. Highly recommend it. And a huge shout out to the guys at HVAC School. Vortex by Tex. So, first thing is voltage across the capacitor. And as you can see, that's 322.6. Okay. The amperage of the motors start winding. So now we're going to take off those carefully. We're going to switch us to amperage. And we're going to get on that purple wire right there. Come on, get on there. Purple wire. Come on. All right, we're on the purple wire. 8.7. So now we're going to go here. 8.7. And then the rated capacitor rating, MDF. As you can see, this is a 7010. So I'm going to type in 70. I'm going to hit calculate. And the amount of variation is acceptable. It's reading at 70 and it's reading 71.55. So that's a deviation of 2.21, which is good. Now, we're going to do the same thing for the fan. I'm going to start with the amperage of the fan. I'm going to type in 10 because that's the microfarad reading. The amperage is reading 0.5. And next we're going to do voltage. Oops, made a boo-boo. We need the brown wire. All right, and that is 1.2, 1.1. All right, we're at 1.1. I have one lead on common, another lead on fan. And I got 307.6. I typed that into the HVAC school calculator and my capacitance reading is fine. It's reading 9.51, which is a variation of 491. And this is plus or minus plus six. So we're still within value, but we're gonna recommend changing this out anyway, only because we're quite close to that. We're almost at five and it's rated for a plus or minus six. So getting close to that. All right, the only reason why I'm checking pressures is because she had mentioned that last year she added a lot of refrigerant to the system. There's our numbers, and there's your fur coat. There's the fur coat. I happen to be a magnet for fur coats, I swear. And I bet you this one has it too. No, see, I was wrong, but just so happens the system I'm working on is wearing a fur coat. And it kind of explains though that high head pressure right there, 285. So we're gonna have to do a coil washing on this bad boy and see how she is afterwards. All right, a lot of you guys ripped me a new one on the last ream that I worked on and I didn't take it apart to clean it. So here's at it. All right. I took all the panels off, got the condenser fan motor off to the side. All the panels are laying in the lady's backyard, and there's your fur coat. Not as bad as I thought it was gonna be, but we do have some buildup on one, two, and three sides, and progressively gets worse on the side facing the house. This is what happens when you neglect your equipment. This is what happens when you neglect your equipment. So now I'm just gonna, just carefully, and don't get bitten by the spider, take out some of the debris. I was gonna put it into a bucket, which for right now, I'll just shove behind the sign right there. I could have put it in a bucket and not dumped into the grass, but it's in the truck. So we're gonna get the hose, which is right here. I got the Viper by Refrigeration Technologies, the Venom Pack. We're gonna dilute the remainder of this with water and then clean down this coil. All right, I have the whole coil sprayed down with the Viper Venom Pack, and I just started to clean this house side and it was filthy, so I just wanted to get this on film to show you guys. I don't know if you could see it, but that water coming out,
That ain't clear water. That's almost like a dark brown. Crazy. Crazy. Think about it. How is this machine breathing if it can't, if you're restricting coil like that? You know? You're not going to be able to extract the heat from the heat exchanger, which in this case, the heat exchanger is my condensing coil, right? We're exchanging heat. The heat exchanger, right? If we can't exchange heat from one medium to another, or get rid of that heat out of that refrigerant, I can't even imagine what their electric bill is like. Look at that. Just took a little bit of time, and it's fairly clean now. But I'm gonna go over that again and go over the other sides and make sure this thing is back to new. All right, a little TLC, and some time later, we now have a clean coil. I took the name panel from this side, put it over there. It's a Ruud, oh well. Got all the panels back together. The coil's nice and clean. While I'm letting the condensing coil heat up, because I just turned the power on, we're gonna wrap up the hose, get rid of all that other stuff we don't need. And then about 5-10 minutes from now, we'll check out the pressures. They were balanced out when I plugged it back in. As you can see now, we're at 58 and climbing and a little under 214 on the high side. All right, so we're gonna let this run. Let that condensing coil heat up because it's got that cold water across it, and then we'll see what our pressures are like. And it's probably low, but we'll still see what's going on anyway. All right, guys, so I ended up adding 2.5 pounds of R410A to the system, discussed the leak search options with the homeowner. She wanted just to add the refrigerant to the system, and we'll be back in the next couple days to install the 7010 dual run capacitor. We installed the Titan HD. I don't use those pros anymore. I like the ones that are made in America. Much better value to the customer. And now that the coil's clean, you know, at least she's not going to be burning up her electric meter. Crazy. And even the sides that didn't look that bad still got a ton of dirt. That water was pretty filthy. So, gentlemen and ladies, all the guys out there in the trades, HVAC trades, wash your coils. Don't neglect your coils. Otherwise, Mikey Pipes is going to find your four coats, and I'm going to take your customers. I'm going to take them, and not to the cleaners. I'm going to take them, put them in my pocket. All right, thank you so much for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed this video, found it entertaining, but most importantly, educational. And the moral of today's video is wash your coils, ladies and gentlemen. Wash your coils. All right, guys, and if you're interested in working for me, Mikey Pipes, down in Lexington, which is the Columbia area of South Carolina, email me, mike@mikeypipes.com. Along with Conrad, we're looking for plumbing technicians, and relocation assistance is available. So hit me up if you're tired of working for a mediocre company and living paycheck to paycheck. You can live a good life down in South Carolina. You can get a lot down there for not that much, you know? If I got rid of my Taj Mahal here in New York, I could probably buy a whole plantation. Crazy. But thanks so much for tuning in, guys. Be well. God bless. See you in the next one. Stay safe.